You're welcome.
Well deserved.
No, that's not
it. Oh, you said it. Okay.
I took it down there already.
No, that's an old one.
This is out of date, too.
Yeah. Okay. All right, we'll get that fixed. I'll talk to Becky.
I put it on her desk down there with a note on it.
Okay.
There's errors in here. It said, one of them said, you know, that except for the first Sunday in every week, we will have children's church.
but that's correct.
Yeah, but the first Sunday in every week is every Sunday instead of month.
That's correct.
But that's what I understand is true, that they've decided to do, that y'all have decided to do children's church every week.
No.
Yeah.
We're not going to do children's church on communion Sundays.
There's a difference between you and Catherine. You need to get that straight.
Exactly.
Because I just, this morning I said, is there children's church today? And I said, yes.
Okay. Let me check with her because Kitty had the same question. That's exactly what I was trying to figure out.
Okay.
Because last week we had the exact opposite.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So when everyone sits down, I'll go to the piano.
Good morning, Grace.
Good morning.
It's good to see you this morning. Good to have you here. If you're joining us online, we're glad that you're able to join us as well. If you have difficulty hearing, I know we've had some difficulty with our audio feed on Facebook Live over the last couple weeks, at least at the beginning of the service. Please use the chat function to let us know that you cannot hear on your end so that we can correct that if we can. There are a lot of mysteries associated with the internet and computers, most of which I am not privy to. So I can either pray for them or lay hands on them violently. I can also use computer language, but you don't want to hear that. We're trying to start a new Sunday school class for Raising Grace parents. So if you're interested, please contact Pastor Catherine. This is for parents of infants through fifth graders. We would like to have a class available for them, because if there's a class for parents, then likely the parents will bring their children to Sunday school. And that's an area where we're still lagging as far as participation as children in Sunday school. So please pray for that. God has answered our prayers before. So if you're interested in leading or co-leading this group, please email Catherine or call the church office, and Catherine will help you with everything you need to get started. Calvin Farian's memorial service will be this Tuesday at 1:00 here in the sanctuary. Yesterday we had an outdoor service for June Sharp, Joanne Julian's mother. Josh Julian's grandmother. She passed away last week, last Sunday, early Monday morning. So that service was outside. This Tuesday's service will be inside. We invite you to come and celebrate Calvin's life at that time. These are all of the announcements I have today. Our liturgist today is Dick Hellyer, and Dick will correct everything that I got wrong.
Hello? Who? Let's see. I'm in church. It's where you ought to be, too. Yes, that's them. They're laughing at me because I forgot to put this thing on silent. Can I call you back after this is over? Okay. Yeah, my car warranty is not out of date. Good morning, fellow seekers. It's a glorious day. I'm surprised you're here. I'm surprised I'm here on such a day, but it's a grand day to worship God. Welcome to Grace on Main. Whether you're seated in this sanctuary or looking at us between your toes in bed on TV or just out fishing and with us in spirit only, we welcome your presence, Spirit, and hope you will be renewed in your experience this morning. If you're visiting with us, please look on the pew in front of you and you'll find one of these yellow cards, or I guess it's yellow, orange or something, and fill it out for us and put it in the offering plate or drop it in the, or stuff it in the hand of one of the ushers when you leave. Because this will help us to get to know you better. We will use the information only within the walls of this church. We would love to know you better, and we'd love to have you as a member of Grace Covenant Presbyterian. Please feel free to ask anyone you may see about us, and for the rest of you, please, if you're asked, smile and help them out and welcome them to a home here at Grace on Main. We have a full range of Sunday school classes and lots of other things, and you may find that the envelope that your bulletin came in has a lot of really good information in it. If you have one of those, feel free to take it home. We will give a few things away here, not too much, but that has a pretty good record of exactly what is available here on a routine basis and sometimes not a routine basis. We also have a hurried family supper on Wednesday night. It's covered in there, but it's a grand opportunity. It's that we have childcare and food, and both for the body and for the soul. So we would enjoy having you there on Wednesday evening. There are some announcements. Because of coronavirus concerns, the movie scheduled for this month, Toy Story 4, is postponed. It will be shown in the springtime sometime when we get everything together. I'm not sure that we'll ever be together again as far as COVID is concerned. We're just going to live with it sooner or later. When you get the offering plate coming around, you will see that one of these white baskets coming around behind it. That is bread for life. You know, if you've forgotten, we no longer take collections of food for Bread for Life because we can buy it through Bread for Life and get much more food than we can by giving it away from us. So money works better than things right now. So please give as you feel free. There will be a fruitful reception after the end of the, worship service is over in the fellowship hall down there. Please stop by and tell us how we did, or, well, don't necessarily tell us, but if you liked it, tell us you'd like that. Please stop by. They will be on those will be now every month on the same day as we have communion. So easy way to remember it. But stop by and say hello to some of the people around. The children's church today will be right after the anthem. But we will now have children's church on every Sunday morning, including Communion Sunday. That's a change to what we've been doing in the past. I think that's all the information I have up here right now. Come near to the Lord, and he will come near to you. Although the Lord is constantly with us, wherever we are, please join me now in bringing our hearts closer to him by responsively declaring the call to worship printed in your bulletin and on the screen. Shout for joy to the Lord of all the earth.
Worship
the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that who made us, and we are his.
We are his people, the sheep of his pasture.
Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name.
For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Holy Father, your word says that you require us to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. Holy Spirit, convict us to live as people of integrity and to treat others fairly. Strengthen us to show mercy to those who oppose us. Jesus, you are our model. Empower us to walk with you in humility, reminding us that you are God and we are not. Attune our hearts and minds to your presence in this place and soften our hearts to receive your truth. We ask these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Please stand if you're able for our opening hymn.
And revives those who are crushed in spirit. Let us admit our brokenness before God and our fellow man as we pray the corporate prayer of confession, followed by a time of silence for personal confession, our personal sins, and the need for his loving forgiveness and grace. God of deliverance, your goodness has sustained us through times of sorrow, pain, and distress. When situations were bleak, you have healed, restored, preserved, and guided us. We confess the self-centeredness and ingratitude that cause us to forget our manifold goodness. Forgive our selfish ways. Awaken us to your presence. Enable us by your Spirit, and that our lives may demonstrate your continued emancipation and blessing lavished upon us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Celebrate, because we are sanctified by God, and Jesus calls us brothers and sisters. As Christ's sisters and brothers, rest secure in the assurance of God's saving love. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Oh.
Let us pray. Living God, help us to hear your holy word so that we may truly understand, and that by understanding we may believe, and that by believing we may follow in faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in everything we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The scriptures today are all New Testament, and they come from Hebrews chapter 9 and 1 Corinthians chapter 5. You may follow along in your pew Bibles, or I guess on the screen as well. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 11 through 27. But when Christ came as high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and perfect tent, not made with hands, not of this creation, he entered once for all and for all into the holy place, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls with sprinkling of the ashes of a heifer sanctify those who have been defiled so that their flesh is purified, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify your conscience from dead works to worship the living God? For this reason, he is the mediator of all of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, because a death has occurred that redeems them from transgressions under the first covenant. Where a will is involved, the death of the one who made it must be established. For a will takes effect only after death, since it is not in force as long as the one who made it is alive. Hence, not even the first covenant was inaugurated without blood. For when every commandment has been told to all the people by Moses in accordance with the law, he took the blood of calves and goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the scroll itself and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant that God has ordained for you." And in the same way, he sprinkled with blood both the tent and the vessels used in worship. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without shedding of the blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Thus, when it was necessary for the sketches of the heavenly things to be purified with these rites, but the heavenly things themselves need better sacrifices than this. For Christ did not enter the sanctuary made by human hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself again and again as high priest enters the holy place year after year, with blood that is not his own. For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for mortals to die once, and after that, the judgment. And from 1 Corinthians verses 6 through 8. Your boasting is not a good thing. Do you not know that a little yeast leavens the whole batch of dough? Clean out the old yeast so that you may be a new batch, as you really are unleavened. For your paschal lamb, Christ, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us celebrate the festival not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and evil, but the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. The word of the Lord.
Please join me in prayer. Lord, give us greater insight into the table around which we gather today, the sacrifice we celebrate, and the Passover. Christ, our Passover, who is sacrificed for us. We give you thanks in his name. Amen. Lou Anne and I were visiting her parents in Wayne, Pennsylvania over Thanksgiving weekend one year, and I happened upon a new store which, when I was still allowed to be a carboholic and eat bread and carbohydrates without consequence, it became my favorite store. It was a national bread company, and I was walking down the street minding my own business, and if you've seen those cartoons of the aroma that comes out and it forms a finger and kind of hooks you in the nose and then you just follow along, that was it. I smelled fresh bread and I was hooked. I had to find this store, and I did. Wow, what a place. I still remember how good that smelled. Memories possess a powerful capacity for making the past visibly and vividly present to us. We remember, we see where we were. And hearing the strains of a familiar or special song can take us back to the moments those notes first invaded our consciousness. Smelling the aroma of popcorn, coffee, baking bread, pipe tobacco. I smelled pipe tobacco. I immediately began to think of my Uncle Jack, who always smoked Prince Albert in a can. Savoring the taste of a bitter or unpleasant food can suddenly bring thoughts and emotions flooding to the surface that were previously part of a distant and forgotten past. I remember how my church smelled when I was a kid. I can still identify that aroma. How interesting then that the New International Version of the Bible uses the word remember 166 different times. There's something about our present, our future, that our past must inform and illuminate. And so Jesus gathers with his disciples in an upper room. They're there to celebrate the Passover feast. They are there to remember their redemption as a people, not as individuals, but as a people. Tradition would place a roast lamb on the table. The lamb would remind them that life was taken and blood was shed to purchase their freedom from bondage. In addition, there would be the other necessary items of Passover. There would be the moror, or the horseradish, bitter root and hot. The parsley and salt water, reminding them of the tears of the people when they were slaves. The roasted shank bone of the lamb, the charoseth, made of apples, nuts, and spices. And the glasses of wine and the unleavened bread, each item had meaning. Each item reminded them of the story of God's redeeming love, and that was rehearsed every year during Passover. And they would hear the story again, a story that could never grow old or outdated. They would become participants in the story, knowing that their celebration radically connected them with the God of the Exodus and the people of God. Why is this night different from any other night? The youngest in the room would ask, and the answer would be given. We were slaves in Egypt. We participate. And they would hear that story. And as Jesus celebrated in the upper room with his disciples, they participated in a tradition that dated back nearly 1,200 years. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper today. And we add another 2,000 years to that story. The Passover lamb. God told them to take it. It was appointed by God. It wasn't a human idea. God instituted the Passover as a means of testing the faith and obedience of Israel, of setting a distinction between those doomed for destruction and those designated for salvation, and prefiguring the lamb that was to come. And so when Jesus comes along, we read the Gospel of John, and in that opening passage in John chapter 1, we get to verse 29, and we read, "The next day John the Baptist, saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, 'Look, to Peter and Andrew, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.'" Now that lamb, before it could be sacrificed, had to be subjected to a time of scrutiny and testing. The Paschal lamb had to be chosen on the 10th day and sequestered until the 14th day. It was watched and examined for 5 days to make sure that it was indeed perfect, that it didn't get sick, that it didn't die of something. Jesus' whole public life and ministry were constantly under scrutiny. He was regularly challenged and tested by the religious authorities. He was tempted by the evil one at the beginning of his ministry in the wilderness. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees watched his every move, tested his every word, questioned his every action, and examined his motives. Matthew 16, 1. The Pharisees and Sadducees came to Jesus and tested him by asking him to show them a sign from heaven. Matthew 22, 35 to 36, one of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Mark 10, 2, some Pharisees came and tested him by asking him, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" So appointed by God, examined, and must be without blemish. Even his enemies could find nothing that Jesus had done that was wrong. Jesus challenged the authorities, questioned their teaching, violated the law, but then superseded it with a spiritual authority that they couldn't deny. And even when he broke the law, Jesus' enemies had to admit that he did so to honor God and to help people. In his trial before Pilate, Pilate was heard to declare, "I find no basis for a charge against this man. He's innocent." And Matthew records in Matthew 27, 19, "While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message." Isn't it great? Our wives always let us know what's really going on. And Pilate's wife said, "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." 1 Peter 1, 18 through 19, "For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." And the lamb had to be slain. All the lambs for Passover were slaughtered at the same time, twilight on the 14th day of the first month of the year. Now, you couldn't just knock the lamb out with a stick or a rock. God instructed that blood had to be shed. Ask Jim Wesson sometime about the whole process, because he sells lambs for sacrifice to the Muslims in Newport News for their holidays. The neck of the animal was slashed and the blood was drained out. Without that blood, there could be no redemption. God instructed them to use hyssop, a plant, to paint the blood of the lamb on their doorposts and their lintels of their homes. And only if the angel of death saw the blood of the lamb would he pass over the house, freeing it from the consequences of God's judgment. And so Jesus, too, had to be slain. How many times had he taught his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and be killed by the chief priests and the elders and on the third day rise from the dead? You see, God's plan and Jesus' agreement to that plan was that the Son of God must die and rise on the third day. The Son's lifeblood must be shed. So when we view the cross, and here we have a Celtic cross, not a simple Latin cross, I think that somehow we must learn to see our own complicity in that death. We can't dismiss this as an act by self-righteous Jews and brutal Romans. We somehow have to understand the horrible fact that Satan sometimes uses religious people to accomplish evil in the world. We distort things, and before long we call evil good and good evil. Every time we allow sin to reduce us with its distortions, we nail Jesus on the cross once again. There's an old episode of MASH in which a rather cocky young pilot comes to the MASH unit because his plane has been shot down, but he is not seriously injured, and he tells everyone in a rather boasting voice that flying really gives him a high. If he could not fly, the war would really be a drag, he said. He brags that every time he flies a couple of missions, they send him back to Japan for several weeks of R&R. And the war to him is really quite a lark. I mean, he's fighting against the Korean and Chinese pilots, but he's a hotshot. He's pretty good. And then one day a Korean child is brought into the MASH unit, and her arms had been terribly mangled in an air attack. The young pilot is suddenly taken aback. Even though it was not his plane that did it, for the first time, he is forced to confront his own complicity in the brutality of war. For the first time, he sees things not from the perspective of 10,000 feet, but he sees war in the eyes of a child. There's a danger in romanticizing the cross. I love the old hymns about the cross just as much as anyone, but the cross is not meant to lull us. The cross is meant to shock us. Hebrews 9:22, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood there is no sacrifice or forgiveness. The lamb could not have its bones broken. God commanded the Israelites to consume the lamb in one house. No meat was to be taken outside the house. None of the bones was to be broken. Jesus was beaten to the point of disfigurement. He was cruelly abused, beaten, whipped, mocked, scorned, and crucified. He was so wounded that it was difficult to recognize Jesus as a man. And so when he dies in excruciating pain, hanging from the cross, the soldiers come to break his legs, to hasten his death, but he is already dead. Jesus' blood is shed, and the law says that the blood must be sprinkled. Each day on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would enter the Holy of Holies and sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice on the mercy seat. He did this three times on the Day of Atonement. He would enter once to make atonement for his own sins. The second time he entered, he would make atonement for the sins of the priests. He would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat once, then seven times. He spattered the ark with blood in front to cover the pollution of the sins of the priests. And the third time he entered the Holy of Holies to make atonement for the sins of the people. I mentioned on Wednesday night when I was teaching on this passage, they say that as many as 400,000 lambs were slaughtered the same week that Jesus died because of all the people in Jerusalem. Can you imagine what that must have smelled like? And how graphic that would be. The priest, the high priest, would then take the blood once more. And mixing the blood of the goat and the bull, he anointed the horns of the altar of incense standing before the veil. And this was a symbol of the prayers of the people of Israel. With his fingers then, he sprinkled the altar of incense with the blood of the sacrifice to cleanse it of Israel's uncleanness. Hebrews 9:23, we don't really understand this, but it provides a vivid picture for us. It was necessary then for the copies of the heavenly things to be purified with these sacrifices, but the heavenly things themselves are purified with better sacrifices than these. For Christ did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence. Today we gather at the table to remember. 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 Jesus said, "This do in remembrance of me." Let us do as he has commanded, and let us remember with thanksgiving what Christ our Passover has done for us today and tomorrow and next week as we reflect on Jesus' sacrifice for us. Soli Deo Gloria, to God alone. be the glory. Amen.
As said, we make a living by what we get.
Thank you.
We make a life by what we give. Let us bless others through gifts that show we care. This morning offering will be received. Dear Lord, we thank you for the richness of your blessings to us. We dedicate these offerings to the work of this church and the glory of your kingdom here on earth. We ask that you use all that we have and all that we are in service to you and our fellow man. In Christ's name, amen.
Here is the table of the Lord. We are gathered to his supper, a foretaste of things eternal. Come when you are fearful, to be made new in love. Come when you are doubtful, to be made strong in faith. Come when you are regretful, and be made whole. Come, old and young, there is room for all.
Let us pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, he took the cup, and giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Your Holy Spirit on we who are gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Pray all this, O God, in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray as we sing.
Kingdom come, thy will be done on earth.
the body of Christ broken for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
We will be receiving by intinction today. If you're not familiar with that, we'll start at the back of the church, come down the center aisle. As you come forward, a piece of bread will be dropped in your hand, so just hold your hand out and you will be handed a small cup of juice. If you'll return to your seat, everything will work swimmingly. So would you please come?
Excuse me.
Or maybe not swimmingly, but it'll work. Oh, I hope not. Josh, the blood of Christ shed for you. Joanne, the blood of Christ shed for you. Becky, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Kitty, the blood of Christ shed for you. Shed for you. Ray, the blood of Christ shed for you. JD, the blood of Christ shed for you. Steve, the blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Tom, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Andy, the blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you. Ginger, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Charlie, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Pam, the blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you. Matt, the blood of Christ.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Becky, the blood.
The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you. Charles, the blood of Christ shed for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. Claudia, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Ted, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Godwin, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Rich,
the blood of Christ shed for you. Sue, the blood of Christ shed for you. Carlos, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Stillman. Let us pray together. Lord God, in deep gratitude for this moment, this meal, these people, we give ourselves to you. Take us out to live as changed people because we have shared the living bread and cannot remain the same.
Ask much of us, expect much from us, enable much by us, encourage many through us. So, Lord, may we live to your glory, both as inhabitants of earth and citizens of heaven. Amen.
Amen. Let us stand and sing together our closing hymn.
Thank you.
Go out into the world in peace. Serve the risen Christ. Know that God loves you, and that in this place you are loved. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you to strengthen you, encourage you, empower you for his service, both now and forevermore. Amen.
We were to know.